that's hot. The mic is hot. I almost felt like today when I came in, the piano had been moved or something. I'm thinking, did I move it? Did I give myself more space? What did I do? And I don't know. I might have, because I've been trying to get a little more space here and there. And so I don't know what I've done in the last few weeks, to be honest. It's just all gone really fast. Oh, man. My voice doesn't sound so great today. Not yet. But so I'm looking for a song that's low key. I mean, low in key. Because I may be singing tenor, it seems like.
10 or 11 be fine.
10 or 11. Oh, Father, we've come to your house to praise you. We've come to your house to worship. We've come to your house to honor you. And I thank you that in this community we have this house. I thank you that in this community we have people that we can gather together with that understand the importance of Shabbat. Thank you, Father. I ask that you would continue to add to us as a community, but not just in number. I ask that you would add to us that which needs to be added, the depth, the study, the ways to communicate with each other. I ask that you would knit us together better, Lord. I know that I've not been real good at that, but you are. So I'm asking that you would do that in this house and in this place. Thank you, Father, for all that you are doing, for everything you have done. And I thank you that we are not alone. You are with us, and we are here together. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. So what should we start with? Do you have a song, Janie, in your brain?
Not for sure.
Okay, well.
Is it a good song?
Which song?
It's just our brother.
Let's do Everlasting God.
Straight forward.
Abba, we wait upon you. We know that you are our God. You are our King. You are the one who comes. You are the one that we sing about. You're the one that we have come to bless. And you are a beautiful God. You are glorious to us. And I thank you. Glorious.
Thank you.
scriptures tell us to make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
Amen.
Okay. So if you can't sing, make a noise. And if you can't sing, sing anyway. Because the reality is God created your voice unique.
Hallelujah.
And he wants to hear your voice.
Amen.
And if you have to just say the words, say the words. I mean, if
Hallelujah.
You're that worried about the melody or whatever, speak the words out. There's something
Amen.
About letting it come out of your mouth
right.
that changes us.
Amen.
The word
right.
says you believe in your heart, but you confess with what?
Your mouth.
So we confess with our mouth that God is good. He is our God, and we will praise him. Let's do
Hallelujah.
Hosanna.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know the word hallelujah is two Hebrew words. Hallelujah is two Hebrew words put together. It's hallelujah. Hallelujah means praise to. Praise to. Well, you know, we're going to praise to. We want to know who we're praising, right?
Yeah.
We're going to praise to. Yahweh, Adonai, our God. Hallelujah. And that word Hallel does not mean sit down and be somber.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory to God.
That's not what it means at all.
Nope.
Hallel means make noise, jump up and down, be conspicuous
Amen.
In your praise. Be conspicuous
Amen.
In your praise. That means if you're in front of the church and you're jumping up and down and someone says, oh, you distracted me, you need to look at them and say, you're looking at the wrong person then.
Amen.
Look at God.
Yeah.
Because the reality is we're supposed to be conspicuous.
It.
It's supposed
Amen.
To be noticed.
That's
People
it.
Are supposed to
That's
realize
it.
We
Amen.
Love him.
Yes.
I remember hearing it taught one time, and I love this version of it, although I'm not sure exactly how Hebraic it is. It's more, you know, Greek version. But, you know, it's okay. It still has a meaning. It's kind of like someone yelling out of the fraternity house, party here! Party! Party!
Yeah.
We're going to party! Hallelujah! We're going to party!
Mm-hmm.
Because of God.
Amen.
Because of who he is.
Oh, a little different party.
Different type of party.
Yeah.
We're
going
to party
right.
for God.
Right.
Party for God.
Party.
And as we praise him, as we worship him, that's when we are saved.
Amen. Hallelujah.
That's when salvation comes. That's when the Hosanna becomes real. Lord, save us. Hosanna doesn't mean... glorious or powerful, or it doesn't have any, it means save us, save us, save us, save us, save us now. It's a pleading.
Amen.
And that is part of our praise. Abba, save us. Praise is rising.
Amen.
Because when house of God. The reading of the Shema as we come into his house, recognizing who he is and who he calls out to. The program is in the front, it is in each pew and behind. Each pew has a program packet that you can pull out and read along with us, so everyone can participate in the readings. Covering the head is not something that is required, but it is something that some of us have chosen out of respect and honor. But it is not required.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be the name of his glorious kingdom forever and ever. Bahafta et Adonai Eloheka bekor lavakor ukar nafshaku ufkor meodecha. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Vahayu hadvarim hayalar asher anoki mitzavka hayom ala vavecha. And these words that I command you today shall be in your heart. Vishnan tam levanecha verabarta bam bevsheka bevteka uvlecha vererech ukshachbeka ufkameka. And you shall teach them diligently to your children, and you shall speak of them when you sit at home, and when you walk along the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. Ukshatam leolot ayadeka v'hayu leptotofot bin inecha. And you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be for frontlets between your eyes. Uktavtam al muzozot biteka uveshareka, and you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Vehava larecha kamoka, and you shall love the low neighbor at yourself.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctifies us with your commandments and commanded us to be a light unto the nations, and has given us Yeshua the Messiah, the light of the world. Abba Father, we thank you for the light that you give us. We thank you that you do not give us a light for us to hide it under a bushel, but to shine it out for the whole world. Thank you for all that you give to us. I thank you that you are the God who spoke, "Let there be light," and there was light. You are the light. Yeshua, you are the light. It is nothing we have done, it is nothing we can do, but you are the light, and I just ask that you would continue to shine through us. Father, I want to thank you for Leanne and that she is here today. You know how often we pray for her. Father, thank you that you give her the freedom to come and worship in your house. Thank you for the healing that you have been doing in her body. I ask for that to continue, to be progressive healing, Lord, that it would continue until she is fully healed, fully able to go about and do what she needs to do for your kingdom. Healing is for your kingdom's sake, Lord. And I ask that for your kingdom's sake, Leanne would be healed completely, absolutely. Father, I thank you and I praise your name for the healing that we have seen in Julie, who was here and who spoke a little bit about it the other night, that Father, you healed her. They went in on that surgery fully expecting there to be cancer. There was nothing there.
Yes. Hey.
When she came back and she went to the follow-up appointment and she said, "So what was this? What is this? And they said, "Well, you know, the only reason for this to look like this on the ultrasounds and tests we did is if there's cancer, but there's no cancer."
Jesus.
We don't know.
Amen.
Father, thank you because you touched her and you healed her.
Right.
And you did so in her obedience and worship.
Right.
You didn't even say to her, "I've healed you." She didn't even know it.
Yes.
And yet, she was healed. There is no cancer in her body.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
And I thank you, Father, for that.
Right.
Father, right now I want to pray for the couple that Craig and I ran into yesterday at Wendy's that I know from another church. And Father, as she said to me, "He has cancer." Everything in me wanted to weep and cry. And Father, I ask right now that even though they're at a congregation that really doesn't understand, doesn't believe in healing, all of that stuff, Father, I ask that you would touch him anyway, because he's been a faithful servant of yours. That couple, is they've been faithful servants in teaching and in reaching people. They've been faithful servants.
Jesus.
So in the name of Yeshua Mashiach, the one that they have been serving in the best of their ability and the best of their understanding, Father, touch his body. Touch him.
Yes.
Right now, Jesus.
You know who I mean, Lord. And Father, I know there's others who need healing. I know there's others, and you don't heal just for a show. Father, forgive us for making a show out of it so many times. It's not a show. You heal for your kingdom's sake. For your kingdom. I ask that we would begin to understand that. And for your kingdom's sake, I ask that more would be healed so that we could testify, so that we could speak, so that we could say, "Yes, this Yeshua that we serve, he is the King of glory. He is the King of glory.
Yes.
He is the King of creation, and he
Lord.
Is King. I know that because he healed me." And only the King can do that.
Yes.
So I ask that you would continue in that way. Father, thank you.
Yes.
For those who can't be here today for other reasons, I know that Julie's been healed of the cancer, but there's other things in her body. And we ask that you would, I come against those things. And I ask that they would release her, that she would be released from the pain.
Yes.
And able to do what she needs to do. She is an apostle in your kingdom. She is an evangelist in your kingdom.
Yes.
She speaks from prophetically, Lord. I ask that you would release her body, that she would be able to minister in the way she's supposed to. And Father, the others here, I thank you for the healing you're doing in Janie. And I ask that you would continue it. Continue it, Lord. Continue it. And I ask for Helene and David, and I ask that they would be returned to us soon. I know that they've been traveling. They've been visiting family. They've been doing all these other things. I ask that you would bring them back to us soon.
Jesus.
And Lord, there are others that I know that are in my head that I can't speak out, but you know them. Father, in this house, I ask that you would be glorified. If there's someone that has been laid on your heart to pray for, now's the time to do it. Speak out so we can hear you. But bring your petitions before God. Now is the time.
Father, I bring Daphne, my sister-in-law in Las Vegas, who, if she's not in surgery already, Lord, she's due for surgery today. Because of the diabetes and the infection in her foot, they want to take that, Father. But, Lord, I just ask you to intervene and do a miracle to give yourself glory. Thank you, Jesus.
God, I pray for the Strength family as they are traveling still. Give them traveling mercies and safety on the road, and bless them all. Bless those who they come in contact with as well, Lord. This other part I've been struggling with saying out loud for a while, because I don't want this to look like it's about me. I don't want it to look like it's about Elizabeth or us at all. It's about you, Lord. You have given us this fantastic building.
Yes.
You have given us
yes.
the ability to come in here to worship you and for Elizabeth to bring the message about you. And God, you have given her the gift of that message.
Yes.
And God, she is speaking for you to the people. But where are the people, God? You've given us this building. It's got 10 pews inside. It's got more pews out in the shed. 10 pews, and we have maybe 8 people here at the most on any given Saturday. God, I ask right now that you would fill these pews, not for us, not to boost my ego that we would have a full house, but God, I ask that you would fill this house so that people can hear your word and your message, God. People, give them a hunger for the truth, God, that they don't necessarily hear in other churches, God. Give them the ability to see that this is your house, God, and that we are not just weirdos out here preaching some weird Jewish thing, God.
It's your word.
Have your way, Lord.
You've given us this place for that purpose. We have dedicated this place to that purpose. It's up to you, God, to bring the people in.
Yes.
We can't go out there and drag people in.
Oh,
we can go out and invite them.
Yes.
And we have.
Yes, Lord.
But we can't force them to come in. We can't drag them in here.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
It's all up to you, God.
Yes.
Bless you, Lord.
Give it to you.
Yes.
Your house.
In the name of Jesus.
Go ahead, Janie.
We call for police. Release of finances.
Yes, Lord.
Release of people.
Yes, Lord.
Release of healing.
Yes,
we
Lord.
Call forth the release of
yes,
God's
Lord.
People, of God's kingdom on this
yes,
earth.
Lord.
We call for that release.
Amen.
We break the chains that are holding
yes,
things back
yes,
and we
yes,
call
yes,
forth God's glory.
Amen.
In the name
yes,
of Jesus,
Lord.
Our Messiah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. I speak to the mountain, I say move. Do you know how big my God is? Do you know how great my God is? I say to the sick one, be healed. Do you know how big my God is? Do you know how great my God is? Savior, restoration. Because that's who we're calling on today. The restoration, the one who brings us together. Makes order out of the chaos, right? You are the God of hope. You are the God of justice. You are the God of healing. The only God who hears. You are the God of hope. You are the God of justice. You are the God of healing. The only God who hears. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you.
Begin our Torah portions all over again. It's the first Shabbat of the new year where the Torah portions are read. And today we begin at the very beginning. Bereshit. Bereshit. Genesis 1:1. We're going to read through Genesis 6:8. There's a lot that happens. So keep your ear out for pictures and signs of the promise of redemption, even in the story of creation and those first generations.
Genesis 1, verse 1, in the beginning. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, one day. Then God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." God made the expanse and separated the waters which were below the expanse from the waters which were above the expanse, and it was so. God called the expanse heaven, and there was evening, and there was morning, a second day. Then God said, "Let the waters below the heavens be gathered into one place, and let the dry land appear," and it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the gathering of the waters he called seas, and God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees on the earth, bearing fruit after their kind, with seed in them." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed after their kind, and trees bearing fruit with seed in them after their kind. And God saw that it was good. There was evening, and there was morning, a third day. Then God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be for lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He made the stars also. God placed them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, and to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. There was evening, and there was morning, a fourth day. Then God said, "Let the waters teem with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth in the open expanse of the heavens." God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarmed after their kind, and every winged bird after its kind, and God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." There was evening, and there was morning, a fifth day. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures after their kind, cattle and creeping things and beasts of the earth after their kind." And it was so. God made the beasts of the earth after their kind, and the cattle after their kind, and everything that creeps on the ground after its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him. Male and female he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Then God said, Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the surface of all the earth, and every tree which has fruit yielding seed. It shall be food for you. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the sky, and to everything that moves on the earth which has life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed, and all their hosts. By the seventh day, God completed his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made earth and heaven. Now no shrub of the field was yet in the earth, and no plant of the field had yet sprouted, for the Lord God had not sent rain upon the earth, and there was no man to cultivate the ground. But a mist used to rise from the earth and water the whole surface of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man of the dust from the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. The Lord God planted a garden toward the east in Eden, and there he placed the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground the Lord God caused to grow every tree that is pleasing to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now a river flowed out from Eden to water the garden, and from there it divided and became four rivers. The name of the first is Pishon. It flows around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold. The gold of that land is good. The bdellium and the onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It flows around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is Tigris. It flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to cultivate and keep it. The Lord God commanded the man, saying, From any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat from it you will surely die. Then the Lord God said, It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. Out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the sky, and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called a living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the cattle, and to the birds of the sky, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper suitable for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh at that place. The Lord God fashioned into a woman the rib which he had taken from the man, and brought her to the man. The man said, This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. For this reason a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. Now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, Indeed, has God said, You shall not eat from any tree of the garden? The woman said to the serpent, From the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat, but from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden God has said, You shall not eat from it, or touch it, or you will die. The serpent said to the woman, You surely will not die, for God knows that in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit and ate, and she gave also to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, And they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loin coverings. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman who you gave to be with me, she gave me from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" And the woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you more than all the cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you will go, and dust you will eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel." To the woman he said, "I will greatly multiply your pain in childbirth. In pain you will bring forth children. Yet your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you." Then to Adam he said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree about which I commanded you, saying, 'You shall not eat from it,' cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you will eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall grow for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you will eat bread till you return to the ground, because from it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return." Now the man called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all the living. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. Then the Lord God said, "Behold, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil, and now he might stretch out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever." Therefore the Lord God sent him out from the heaven, from the Garden of Eden, to cultivate the ground from which he was taken. So he drove the man out, and at the east of the Garden of Eden he stationed the cherubim and the flaming sword which turned every direction to guard the way to the tree of life. Now the man had relations with his wife Eve, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain. And she said, "I have gotten a man-child with the help of the Lord." Again she gave birth to his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of flocks, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. So it came about in the course of time that Cain brought an offering to the Lord of the fruit of the ground. Abel, on his part, also brought the first of the firstlings of his flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and for his offering, but for Cain and for his offering he had no regard. So Cain became very angry, and his countenance fell. Then the Lord God said to Cain, "Why are you angry, and why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will not your countenance be lifted up? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door, and its desire is for you, but you must master it." Cain told Abel his brother, and it came about when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel his brother and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is Abel, your brother?" And he said, "I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?" And he said, "What have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. Now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you cultivate the ground, it will no longer yield its strength to you. You will be a vagrant and a wanderer on the earth." Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is too great to bear. Behold, you have driven me this day from the face of the ground, and from your face I will be hidden, and I will be a vagrant and a wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me." So the Lord said to him, "Therefore, whoever kills Cain, vengeance will be taken on him sevenfold." And the Lord appointed a sign for Cain, so that no one finding him would slay him. Then Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Cain had relations with his wife, and she conceived and gave birth to Enoch. And he built a city and called the name of his city Enoch after the name of his son. Now to Enoch was born Irad, and Irad became the father of Mahujael, and Mahujael became the father of Methusael, and Methusael became the father of Lamech. Lamech took to himself two wives. The name of the one was Ada, and the name of the other Zillah. Ada gave birth to Jabal. He was the father of those who dwell in tents and have livestock. His brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all those who play the lyre and the pipe. As for Zillah, she also gave birth to Tubal-Cain, the forger of all implements of bronze and iron, and the sister of Tubal-Cain was Naamah. Lamech said to his wives, Ada and Zillah, listen to my voice. You wives of Lamech, give heed to my speech, for I have killed a man for wounding me and a boy for striking me. If Cain is avenged sevenfold, then Lamech 77-fold. Adam had relations with his wife again, and she gave birth to a son and named him Seth. For she said, God has appointed me another offspring in place of Abel, for Cain killed him. To Seth, to him also a son was born, and he called his name Enosh. Then men began to call upon the name of the Lord. This is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day when God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. He created them male and female, and he blessed them and named them man in the day when they were created. When Adam had lived 130 years, he became the father of a son in his own likeness, according to his image, and named him Seth. Then the days of Adam, after he became the father of Seth, were 800 years, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died. Seth lived 105 years and became the father of Enosh. Then Seth lived 807 years after he became the father of Enosh, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. Enosh lived 90 years and became the father of Kenan. Then Enosh lived 815 years after he became the father of Kenan, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Enosh were 905 years, and he died. Kenan lived 70 years and became the father of Mahalalel. Then Kenan lived 840 years after he became the father of Mahalalel, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Kenan were 910 years, and he died. Mahalalel lived 65 years and became the father of Jared. Then Mahalalel lived 830 years after he became the father of Jared, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years, and he died. Jared lived 162 years and became the father of Enoch. Then Jared lived 800 years after he became the father of Enoch, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. Enoch lived 65 years and became the father of Methuselah. Then Enoch walked with God 300 years after he became the father of Methuselah, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Methuselah lived 187 years and became the father of Lamech. Then Methuselah lived 782 years after he became the father of Lamech, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Methuselah were 969 years, and he died. Lamech lived 182 years, and he became the father of a son. Now he called his name Noah, saying, "This one will give us rest from our work and from the toil of our hands arising from the ground which the Lord has cursed." Then Lamech lived 595 years after he became the father of Noah, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. Noah was 500 years old, and Noah became the father of Shem, Ham, and Japheth.
Now it came about, when men began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves, whomever they chose. Then the Lord said, My spirit shall not strive with man forever, because he also is flesh. Nevertheless, his days shall be 120 years. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came in to the daughters of men, and they bore children to them. Those were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. The Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. The Lord said, I will blot out man whom I have created from the face of the land, from man to animals to creeping things and to birds of the sky, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord.
We delight, we delight, we delight.
things that as we were praying about beginning this ministry is as we've been meeting in my home and even before that with a couple of people praying about, Lord, what do you want us to do? What do you want? There were some things God told me he loves. I said, what do you want in a worship? What would honor you? What brings you glory? What do you like? You know, because a lot of people go to church for what they like. We go to a church because we like the youth group, because we got teenagers, right? We go to a church because we like the pastor, because he's energetic and on fire, and he jumps up and down, and he gets us all excited. Yeah, well, I don't do that, but maybe someday.
You're just excited.
I get excited, yes, but I'm not going to, anyway, I'm not going to say what I'm not going to do, because I have no idea where God's going to take me, right? But we go to a church because of what we like. We like the music. We like the worship team. We like that we can fly flags, or we like that it's nice and stately and in order, and that works with our personality. You know, we all have different personalities and different things we enjoy. So I was asking God, what do you like? And there were a couple things that jumped at me right away. And one is out of Paul's instructions to Timothy, where he says, do not neglect the reading, the public reading of my word. And I heard that loud and clear, the public reading of my word. And I went, God, you like to hear your word.
Hallelujah.
You like, you love hearing your words coming out of our mouths. What a concept. How many churches still do public reading of the word? Not very many. The church I grew up in did. Every Sunday, there was, and it was done responsibly. So that in a way that the pastor read one verse, the congregation the next, you know, back and forth. And even today, that church does that, but they take selections out of the back of their hymn book now. I much prefer just going to the Word. But there's this place of hearing the Word of God. So that was the first thing God told me needed to be a part of our services. I'm like, okay, Lord. The Torah portions are something that God has set up in the Hebraic and in the Jewish people for generation after generation after generation. When Yeshua walked to the earth, it tells us that it was customary for him to go to the synagogue. It was his custom to go to the synagogue. It tells us that in the part where he talks about it was his custom. He went to the synagogue in Nazareth, and he was asked to get up and read. And what did he read? He got to read what was called the Haftarah portion, what we call the Haftarah. And that's the portion out of the prophets. You see, different people took turns reading different parts. And even today in a synagogue, there will be different people reading different selections. Every single day, if you go to Chabad.org, you can find it broken down into daily portions. You can break it down in just this little bit that you read. You know, some of it is like, sometimes it's like five verses. Sometimes it's a lot more than that. But it's a daily reading, a daily study. And every day there's a portion that is read. And in the synagogues around the world, 2 days during the week, they gather in the morning, and that is their Torah portion, their Torah service, and they read part of that week's thing, that week's Torah portion. And on Shabbat, they finish it off. So they don't read all of it in one setting necessarily like we do, but they get together. So by the end of the week, you've read this whole portion. Of course, they do it in a different language than we use. They do it in Hebrew. And so you have to study the Hebrew and learn the Hebrew to be able to be invited up to the bima, to be able to be invited up to the table where the Torah scroll is rolled out. You have an assistant that stands there and helps you read it. And people study. Part of a bar mitzvah is to learn the Torah portion that would have been read on your birthday, the year you're bar mitzvahed, so that you can read that portion from the scroll. 13 years old, they are reading Hebrew from the scroll. Not a translation, Hebrew. And they're supposed to understand what it means. The rabbi's supposed to be able to quiz them afterwards as to what does it mean. So it's not just memorizing a song of certain words. They're supposed to understand it. That's their Torah portion. It's actually believed that their life should be focused around that portion. That part of what God's going to do with them in their whole life comes out of that portion. It's kind of an interesting concept. There's a lot of things in the Hebraic understanding that we kind of look at and we go, oh, that's kind of cool. It's kind of nice. But why does that apply to me? How does that apply to me? Well, it implies to us, because guess what? We're reading God's written word. He wrote it in a certain way, and he gave it to a group of people, and he told them to guard it and to keep it. And they do guard, and they do keep. And he gave them instructions as for how to understand it and how to apply it. And they do that. And there's a, sometimes there's things that we may not understand, we may even disagree with. But God gave it to the elders of Israel to study it out. And so we study it together too. I'm going to tell you something. There's many in this first portion, just these verses, I can rattle off several pictures of redemption. In the English, right? That's the surface level that we read it in the English. Did you see signs, promises of God for the redemption of man? Did you see that? It's all through it. It's in the English even. It's that obvious. But just like God likes to do something obvious, he also sometimes hides his message. And he puts it into different things. I'm going to read to you from Hebrew, the first verse, Genesis 1:1. Why am I banging that? Aha, this got moved. Okay. There. And that won't bang it. Okay. Genesis 1:1. Now this is in the Hebrew, okay? בראשית ברא אלוהים את השמיים ואת הארץ. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Okay, in the beginning is בראשית. ברא אלוהים is our God. He's the one doing the action. השמיים ואת הארץ is saying the heavens and the earth. Now there's a middle word in there. And that word is et. It's spelled with an aleph, and then it has a vowel marker on it to make sure you have the eh sound instead of the ah sound. And tav, aleph and tav. Aleph is the first letter of the alphabet, aleph bet. Tav is the last letter of the aleph bet, aleph and tav. You know, Yeshua spoke Hebrew, not Greek. So when he was meeting with John on the Isle of Patmos, I doubt very much if he said, I am the Alpha and Omega. I doubt it because he didn't speak Greek to his disciples. He spoke Hebrew to his disciples. He in all probability said, I am the Aleph and the Tav. I am the first and the last. I'm the beginning of the alphabet. I am the end of the alphabet. That is me. I am that. I am him. I am that one. Here in the very first verse, there's a word that literally is a directional word. It's only used to be to apply something. It doesn't have any real meaning other than that this is the one that other than whatever follows it is the one that the action is taken on. So the beginning of the verse, you have somebody. And then it says, et, and what they do. And the somebody is doing something to this. That et is kind of a to. It's in the beginning, God, moving towards heaven and earth, he did something to heaven and earth. He created heaven and earth. And that little word that says that is that word et, aleph and tav. In the beginning, the aleph and the tav created heaven and earth. Who is the aleph and the tav? That is Yeshua. That's hidden in the Hebrew. We wouldn't see that if all we do is read it in the English. We wouldn't understand that. The very first verse, the very first five words include Aleph and Tav together as one word, who is what Yeshua said he is. I am the Aleph and the Tav. It's a picture of our Messiah right there in the Torah scroll, right up there. It's there. We look at it and it's obvious. Those who love Yeshua study it and it's obvious to us. Those who don't love Yeshua, those who haven't, look at it and go, really? That's what you see? Well, my question to them is, does it violate the rest of this? See, according to Hebraic application, according to the understanding, there's different levels of understanding of God's word. There's a surface level that is obvious. It's right there. It's black and white. It's stated. This is clear. Then there's another level, and that usually has to do with the phrasing, how it's phrased, and that phrase can mean multiple things. Then it goes down into the word level, and then it goes down into the letter level, and they even study the spaces between the letters in the scroll that have meaning. Everywhere there's a space in the scroll, there's a reason for the space. Everywhere there's a difference in the way the letter is written, there's a reason for it. There are times that letters are written bigger. There are times the letters are written smaller. Each of those has a meaning, has a purpose, has a reason in that scroll. Understanding that none of these deeper meanings can ever violate the surface meaning. If it violates the surface level, if it violates the natural, what is on the level, on the top, what was first read, if it violates that, then that's not what God is saying. So there's, even in the discussions and even in the looking at the different, the more esoterical levels, even in digging down and deep and looking at all that, it cannot violate what God has said in the plane. You know, there's so much in the plane that sometimes I've thought, why do we dig deeper? Well, because you know what? The word says that God likes to hide things, and it's the right role and the right of the king to search out the answer. Are we kings in his kingdom? Then we're supposed to be searching out his answers. We're king's kids, guys. He hides things for us. They're treasures. Should we not look for the treasures too? That's one of those things that adds such depth that makes it so that I can study this and 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 study this. And every time I study it, if I study it right, I'm going to see more. I'm going to see deeper. I'm going to understand better. Right? People who read it and go, oh, I read that already. I look at them and go, really? Maybe you need to read it deeper. Because there's so much in God's word that every single bit of it is going to jump at us. It's going to say something. It can teach us. In Bereshit, in the beginning, it says God created the heaven and the earth. He acted on these things, and it's the Aleph and the Tav that acts. It's Yeshua, our Messiah, taking part in creation. And it wasn't long before what he did, part of that creation kind of rebelled against him, didn't it? Didn't they? We can easily look at it and go, oh, well, I wouldn't have done that. Be careful. Be careful. We probably all would have done that given the opportunity, given the same circumstances. Adam and Eve are no different. We are no different than they are in that aspect. Mm-hmm. You know, it is said that God told Adam not to eat of the tree, and Adam told Eve, don't even touch it. That Adam put a fence around it without telling her that the real God really doesn't want us to eat of it, so let's not even touch it. He didn't say it that way. He just said, don't touch that tree. Stay away from that tree. Don't touch that tree. Instead of saying, God has told us not to eat of that tree. And some think that fence is part of that fence around God's word, that expansion of it is part of the fall, part of the problem. Well, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. The reality is Eve was tempted. The accuser convinced her that she wanted to be like God, which is what he had done in the beginning, isn't it? Isn't that the major fall of Lucifer? Wasn't that his fall? He wanted to be like God. He wanted to be worshipped like God. He wanted to be God. And so he's looking at Eve, God's creation, and he knows that they were made in God's image. As such, they have something he will never have. We have something the angels can never have. We've been made in God's image. We've been given the ability to create. We have been given all kinds of things because we are made in his image. And the accuser, HaSatan, looked at that and said, ah, but I want to be God. I know how to change this. I'm going to convince them that they need to be God too. So when he said to her, if you eat of this tree, you will be like God. You'll be like God. Look, you can be God too. And he deceived her. Do you think God knew that was going to happen ahead of time? Mm-hmm. Oh, of course he did. Of course he did. He had to have. He's the one that knew all of it, right? He knew about it ahead of time. We have verses, and I'm going to find the verse because I need to be able to give you this chapter and verse. I got all these notes I'm skipping. Aren't you happy? That God created the cure before even the plague came. Okay. He created lambkind. He created mankind. But before even that, he created Yeshua. He set up the plan of our salvation. Even before he created man, it says in 1 Peter 1:20, you can look in Ephesians 1:4 and Revelation 13:8, it talks about the lamb slain before the foundation of the earth. The lamb slain from the foundation, before he ever even created man, he set it up for our salvation. He set it up. He created the cure, even as he created the one who would become sick. He is God. He does all that. He can do all that. I've had people ask me, why do you study the Hebrew? Because there's so much richness in it. You know, we can look at the surface level. We can see that God told Eve that from her would come a seed that would crush the serpent's head. The serpent would crush her heel, right? We can see the promises of salvation and all that. Did you know there's a whole nother chapter in here where the promises are very, very specific? And yet you won't see them unless you look in the Hebrew. Because it comes from the names of the people. There are 15 generations from humanity, from humanity's creation to the Tower of Babel. 15. 15 is a powerful number. Has to do with God's grace. 15 generations. The first is Adam. His name is Adama, Adama, which means earth, ground, soil. Actually, it means red earth. Red earth. Adam was made from the red earth. In fact, the word Adom means red. So Adam was named for the red earth he was created from. Eve, we call her Eve, right? But in the Hebrew, her name is not Eve. It's Chava, C-H-A-V-A-H, Chava, which comes from the word Chaya, which means living, because she was the mother of all living things. So we have Adama, we have Adam, who comes from the red earth. We have Chava, who is the mother of the living, because it's living. Cain, they pronounce it Chana, Cain. It's not Cain, it's Cain. But it comes from a word that means to get or to acquire or to gain. And it says, the man knew his wife Eve, his wife Chava. She conceived and gave birth to Cain and said, I have gotten a man from Yahweh. You see, the way they named their children was a direct relationship to who they were and what they were supposed to be. Chavel, it comes from the word Havel. Haval, which means to breathe out. Vain or a waste. Shet. Shetat means to set in place. Adam knew his wife again. She gave birth to a son and named him Shet. Elohim has set me another seed in place of Chavel, for Cain killed him. Okay, so we're used to these Cain and Abel. Chain, Havel are the Hebrew names. Enosh means to be sick, incurably sick. Chanan, same word as Cain, which means to get or to be given from God. Mahalel, he wrote all these names. Right? I've got a paper I'm going to hand out. You can have. Okay. In fact, Craig, you want to go ahead and hand these out? Mahalel comes from the word halal, which means to praise God. To praise God, halal. Mahalel, praise God. It's just like hallelujah. Yared, meaning to descend. Chanak, meaning to dedicate or concentrate. Consecrate. Each one of these. Methuselah means from mayet, meaning to die, you, and shalach, which means to send. Basically, Methuselah's name means when he dies, it happens. Did you get that? Poor Methuselah. Methuselah's name means when he dies, it happens. And that happening is a reference to the flood that God is going to bring on the earth. when he dies. And in fact, he died the year before the flood was sent. When he died, judgment came, just like had been promised in his name. Lamech, from or to. Noach, meaning rest or comfort. They called his name Noah. This one will give us rest from our work. How did Noah give them rest? He went on the ark. Through his obedience to God, there was salvation. All of these have meaning, okay? Even after, where he talks about them. So now I'm going to read these words with their meaning in order, okay? Man, Adam, has gotten futility and acquired vanity and purchased waste. That's Cain and Abel put together. Cain means to get. Abel means vanity, waste. Has been set in sickness and appointed illness and stuck in mortality. Seth and Enosh both have that meaning. Illness, mortality. But to his praise, Mahalel. Then there's Jared, which we hadn't read yet in this list. Jared, which means to descend. It says, will descend. Enoch. Where am I at? There, yeah. Enoch, dedicate and train men to teach. Through his death, he will send Methuselah to the stricken and the wounded. Lamech, comfort and rest. Noah. In the first 10 generations, the first 15 generations, we have meaning in every name. The front of your paper gives all of these different meanings. The Peleg means to divide, and it explains a little bit that in his days the earth was divided. See, the word name he was given at birth is produced in his life, right? On the back is how it's been put together to tell us a story. Man has gotten futility, acquired vanity, and purchased waste. He has been set in sickness and appointed illness and is stuck in mortality. But to his praise, God will descend to rededicate, to train men, and to teach that through his death he will send to the stricken and wounded comfort and rest. Who do you think that's talking about? Now, I didn't come up with this. I'm not that smart. But I know who did come up with this. His name is Izzy Avraham. And this is from the Holy Language Institute. This is the group I've been studying Hebrew with. And one of the things I know is that I can trust when they have looked it out, when they have searched it out, they can support it multiple ways. I've watched that happen. There's a reality that when we study under someone, we're going to absorb some of the things, right? So you want to make sure who you study under is giving you truth. You don't want to study under someone who's giving you false or part truth, or just a little bit of truth. You want to study under someone who's got the whole of it, right? So when I study, I look for that. And you know how I know who to study from? You're going to love this one. God told me you'll know them by their fruit. Didn't Jesus tell us that? You will know them, we will know them by their fruit. What is the fruit? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, out of Galatians. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. So I look for the fruit of the Spirit. And then I constantly ask God to show me, because every single one of us has something wrong. Okay? None of us have it perfect. We don't. Paul even supports that at the end of 1 Corinthians 13, where he says, for now we see through a glass darkly, but then we'll see face to face. So right now we're looking in these mirrors that are kind of foggy. Have you ever looked in the mirror, tried to look at yourself in the mirror right after you get out of the shower and it's all foggy and you can kind of almost see the image, but you really can't and you have to clean the mirror off, right? Well, we all see through a foggy mirror right now. So that the best of us probably don't have it all. But if we will dig in and we will study, God will use what we do have and what we do understand, and he will give us more as we study more. He will give us more. And he will lead us to teachers we can trust. I sometimes say things up here that people go, where'd she get that from? And that's all right. There are things that I believe you're not going to agree with. That's okay. We're not going to agree on everything. You get You know, I used to joke, and I know some of you have heard this before, that if you get any four Baptists in a room on any given Wednesday night, you're going to have four opinions, right? Well, you get four Jews in a room, you're going to have eight opinions, because each of them can see two sides. And none of those sides are going to agree necessarily. And we sit down with this word, and we study it, and we study it, and we study it, and we come to conclusions, and sometimes those conclusions make sense. And then someone else looks at it and goes, yeah, but I see it this way. You know, a diamond doesn't have just one surface to look at. There are multiple ways to look at it, multiple applications. God's word is like that. There's multiple ways to see it, multiple ways to apply it. And sometimes God takes something completely out of context to speak a word of truth and hope to you. And I am not going to be one to tell you that wasn't God. But if God does take something out of context to speak hope and truth to you, beware that you don't make it a doctrine for everybody. Because it doesn't apply to everybody that way. But God has taken it and lifted it and made it a rhema word, a right now word, a breathed out word. He breathed it to you. And that's powerful. But I want to warn us not to make doctrines out of something that's been taken out of context and spoken to you. Because that might not be what it's really talking about. But it's what God's given you. So accept it. Accept what God speaks to you. God speaks all kinds of things to all kinds of people. And sometimes it feels like they are at opposite sides. But in reality is, it isn't. You know, God says, I knew you before the foundation of the world. That's called, anyone know the big doctrinal word for that? That's called predestination or election. God chose you to be His child before the foundation of the world, just like he chose Yeshua, just like he set all that up. It says he knew you before you were born, right? He chose you. But then again, he also says, whosoever will may come. And it says, choose you this day whom you will serve. Choose you. You choose. So we have God choosing, and we have us choosing. And I've sat in rooms where people argue this. God chooses who's going to be saved, and he knows who's going to be saved, and he knows who won't be, and he's the one who chooses. Great. But God also says we need to choose. Oh, we don't have a choice. It's God chooses. Then why did God say, choose you this day whom you will serve? You see, they seem to be opposite each other. They seem to contradict each other. But you know what? In God's kingdom, they don't. God has chosen you so that you can have a choice. We used to kind of joke about it this way. On the outside of the door, it says, all may come. Whosoever will may come. On the inside of the door, when you turn around and look, it says, I knew you were coming. And because I knew you were coming, I've set you up for these good things. But you still have to choose to come through the door. Right? They're not really opposites. Sometimes we define something differently and we think, huh, I wonder. There are many, 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 many sermons I have heard on Cain and Abel's argument. And why did God not accept Cain's offering? What were you told? Were you told, like I was, that God didn't accept the offering because it wasn't a blood offering and blood offering is required for sacrifice? That's what I was taught. That's what I was taught. There's a part of that that is true. For a sin offering, blood must be shed. That's consistent through Scripture. But nowhere does it tell us that this is supposed to be a sin offering. And there are times in Torah, there are offerings that are not blood offerings. There's a meal offering, grain offering. There's a wine offering or a libation where you pour it on the altar. There's offerings of thanksgivings that literally are the first fruits offerings, and you bring the first of what you have grown from the trees, from the plants, from your work. The first is brought. That's an offering to God, and God receives it. I'm going to read this a little differently, okay? So it happened after some time that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to Adonai, while Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flocks and their fat portions. And Adonai looked favorably upon Abel and his offering, but upon Cain and his offering, he did not look favorably. And Cain became angry, and his countenance fell. You want to know why the sages believe that God did not receive Cain's offering? It had nothing to do with the fact that it wasn't blood. It had everything to do with Cain's attitude. He picked up some of the fruit, and he brought it in. It does not say it was the best. It does not say it was the first. It does not say it was done with an absolute, with love and joy. It just says he brought some of the fruit from the ground. Literally, you could translate, he brought some of the fruit from the ground. He went through his orchard, and he picked up fruit that had fallen into the ground, and he brought it. You could interpret it that way. Do you think God wants an offering of what's fallen? God says, I want your first. Your best belongs to him. Your best and your first belongs to him. The other aspect of this is God spoke to Cain, and he said, why are you angry? If you do well, this will lift. If you don't, sin is crouching at the doorway, and its desire is for you. You must master it. You see, God used it to teach Cain something. Cain could have said right then and there, God, why didn't you like my offering? What was wrong? What could I do different? What should it have been? What was wrong? But the reality is Cain doesn't ask God that question, does he? He's just upset. He's mad. I brought a gift and you didn't like it. You liked my brother's gift. And there was a jealousy that rose up. Sometimes we look at what God is doing in someone else's life, and instead of going to God and saying, God, I feel like I work my tail off for you, and I don't feel like you're blessing me at all for it. What? We need to do that. We need to say, what, Lord? What? Not look at somebody else and say, well, they're getting blessed and I'm not. That's horrible. And get mad at them. Excuse me, that's called jealousy and envy, and we're not supposed to do that. That violates the commandments, right? Don't look at what your brother has. Don't look at what don't look at what your neighbor has. Don't be jealous. Look to God. If Cain had turned to God and when God said, why are you angry and why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, it will lift. If you don't do well, sin's crouching at the door, its desire is for you, you must master it. If Cain had turned around and said, God, I'm fallen because I brought you something, then God could have corrected his behavior. But he didn't. He stayed mad. He had an argument with his brother, and he killed his brother. And the second time in Scripture, we have God ask a question as to where somebody is. Right? The first time he asks Adam and Eve, where are you, when he comes into the garden, do you think God knew where he were? God knew where they were. He knew fully where they were. This time he's asking Cain, where's your brother? Does God know where his brother is? Absolutely. This is Cain's next opportunity to do it right. Just like when he spoke to Adam and Eve, that could have been the moment that they immediately repented. But they didn't. They argued amongst themselves. They blamed everybody else. Blamed it on this one. Blamed it on that one. Cain gets mad, and instead of answering the question and saying, I have a temper problem, God, I killed my brother. He said, what? Am I my brother's keeper? I'm responsible for him. And then God says something that really hits home. The voice of your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground. Did you know that when we shed blood, that blood cries out to God? Mm-hmm. I think that's one of the reasons why the blood offering is required for sin offering. Because blood cries out to God. That blood cries out to God. I don't understand that. I don't know why. But the land is polluted because of bloodshed. He speaks about that elsewhere. The bloodshed, the bloodshed, the bloodshed. The life is in the blood, right?
Yes.
I have a very dear friend that I really enjoy and I love being with. I'm absolutely convinced that a child in the womb is not a person until they've been born and they breathe air. Because God breathed into Adam breath, and then he was a living soul. So the soul isn't there until he breathed. And I look at the scripture and I say, the life is in the blood. When is the blood flowing in that baby? And the blood is flowing in that baby way before birth.
Right.
Life is already there. Already a human. Already. way before birth. And the blood cries out from the ground to Abba. The blood does. There's so much we could go into just in these few verses, just in this passage. I could spend an hour just talking about the different offerings and how they're accepted, what they're for, and we could midrash, we could discuss why it wasn't accepted, but the Bible doesn't tell us exactly, does it? So we can't make any doctrines out of that. But churches have. God doesn't explain a lot of things to us that we make doctrines out of, make them hard and fast rules. What can we say out of all of this that's hard and fast and certain? We can say God created us. We honor our Creator. We can say man has sinned. We acknowledge that sin and we know that we all have sinned. And we can say that God provides an out. He provides reconciliation. He provides forgiveness. He provides grace. He comes to Adam and he said, Adam and Eve, and he says, where are you? All they had to do is say, we're here, Lord. We're sorry. He came to Cain and he said, where's your brother? All Cain had to say was, I got mad and I killed him. He's always asking us, where are you? Does he know where we are? Absolutely, he knows where you are. He knows where your heart is. He knows where your mind is. He knows everything like that. But he still asks us, why? Because he wants us to know where we are. We need to know where we are. Because until we know we're lost, we can't cry out for a savior. Until we know we have a disease, we can't cry out for healing. Until we recognize and acknowledge that we're just human, we can't say, Abba, Father, I need your spirit to direct me today. Until we acknowledge we're not perfect, which none of us are, we can't ask for his perfection. Until we say, you know, there's a lot in this I don't know, but there's stuff I do know, and Lord, let me help me be strong in what I do know. See, if we look at this, well, I know it. You've just lost the fruit of the Spirit in your life. If I look at this and I say, well, I know this, and that guy says that, so he must be totally wrong, and God judge him. Well, now I've just lost the fruit of the Spirit in my life, and I've just acted in a way that is contrary to God's word. You see, something I've learned. 10 years ago, I taught this. Well, let me go back. 20 years ago, I taught this from a purely Baptist background. Why? Because I was a grown-up Baptist. I went to Baptist Bible College. I studied Schofield's notes. You know, I knew this stuff. I knew it inside and out, and I knew I was right. And one night I spent a couple hours explaining to people how come this falling on your face, falling on your back, and this slain in the spirit stuff can't be of God because I don't see it in the Bible. And I pulled out chapters and verses, and I explained it to him, and I showed him, and I was dogmatic. And it wasn't... See, that was on a Friday night. The next Wednesday, I visit this funky little church, and the pastor says, can I pray for you? And I said, sure, why not? So I stand up. He says, come here, stand up, right here. I stand there, and he does like that. Now, his hand is about as far away from my head as the mic is from my hand. And he prayed for me, and I flew back. I went backwards, and I landed hard, and I did not get up again for a long time. And in my spirit, I just kept hearing God say, don't tell me what I can't do. Don't tell me what I can't do. I just spent Friday night over an hour explaining why God can't knock people backwards because his word doesn't support that. And here I am backwards on the floor hearing his spirit saying, don't tell me what I can't do, going, and I ran from that church for a while. Because, you know, that's a scary experience for a Baptist, right? So 20 years ago, I would have told you that can't happen. Not much after that, I was looking at the scripture, and I'm studying it out, and I'm seeing that God can do whatever he wants to. And if he needs to knock you flat on your back to convince you that he's God, he will do it. If he knows you'll listen. He can do what he wants to. God said, take me out of that little box you've got me locked up in. He can't fit in it. But we tend to be the ones that stay in those little boxes. And then he began teaching me other things. And as I began teaching on some of these things, the things I taught about the festivals and the feasts when I first began all this were one way. And now God's showing me more and more and different. And you know what? The way I'm teaching it today is certainly not the way I taught it 10 years ago, which certainly goes against some of the stuff I taught 10 years before that. And what I'm saying is, as we grow, as we study, as we learn, as God reveals things to us, recognize that it may be totally different than you think it will be. Not only that, but 10 years from now, you might see it even different. It's a process. We are to go from glory to glory to glory. We're not supposed to go to this glory and stay sitting there and stay stuck. A lot of us are so afraid of hearing something different that we don't hear it all. We're so set, and this is exactly what it has to say. That passage has to be. He didn't accept Cain's offering because it wasn't blood, because blood is required for the sacrifice. I was taught that. I believed that. I thought that was certain. I've heard teachings on that that make it a phenomenal doctrinal issue. Blood is required. But that's not part of what that part's teaching necessarily. So let's be aware that just because we've thought it was so doesn't make it so. God is still God, though, and he's going to love us through the whole thing. He's going to love us through the whole thing. He loves us through our transitions, through our changes. He brings us from one place to the next, to the next, to the next. He doesn't want us to stay stuck in ourselves. It isn't about the frozen chosen. It's about the ones who God wants to delight in, and so we will delight in him. So if I say something you don't agree with, let's sit down and talk about it. And we may still not agree, but you know what? What's important? Jesus is our Savior. Mm-hmm. So we'll stick on that. Abba, Father, thank you for today. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for what you are doing. Thank you for where you are bringing us. This is a walk. This is a path. And we've chosen to follow after you on this path. And we don't want to stay stuck in one place. We want to go farther and farther and farther and closer and closer and closer to you and what you have and what you want. Thank you for all you've given. Thank you for all you do. Thank you that you cry out to us, where are you? Not so we can stay there, but so we can recognize where we are, and we can recognize where you are, and we can move even closer to you. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord and our Savior. Amen and amen. Those papers that I gave you, I think they're kind of cool. Read them. Look at them. Meanings in Hebrew have a reason. There's a reason God spoke Hebrew, and there's a reason that's written in Hebrew. It's a picture language, and we learn from pictures. So we're going to keep going. We're going to keep learning. We're going to keep growing, and hopefully and prayerfully we grow together, and we learn together, and we are added to. Thank you, Craig, for that prayer today.
Yeah, amen.
That needs to come. That's exactly where it needs to come from. And I appreciate that. That's not something he's good at doing, or he likes to do, I should say. You're good at it. Don't ever think you're not, because that was powerful.
Yeah,
right? That was powerful. Some of you have prayers that are heavy on your hearts that you're afraid to pray out to. Guess what? If God put it on your heart, you're the one that's supposed to pray it out. And it becomes powerful. We've been doing Tuesday morning and Tuesday evening prayers. We're going to continue with the Tuesday evening prayer. 6:30 Tuesday evenings here in the sanctuary. I have a couple of women I have been praying with, but I'm being very careful with that right now because of where they're at and what they need. If you want to be part of a prayer time, let me know. Because you know what? The house is built on prayer.
Mm-hmm.
We can't do anything without prayer.
Amen.
And so we're trying to get that, I'm trying to get that done. It's also not built without study. And I am still looking at trying to find a night that we can do Bible study, where we can sit down at a table, and even during the day maybe, sit down at the table and hash it out, discuss it. What do you see? How do you see it? Where did you get that? Who taught you that? How do we learn this? Where's this? That we can discuss. So I'm not the only one putting words out. Roger, you have a verse for us today, passage that you've memorized? or not even, just that you need to share.
Well, you asked about a prayer that I was reluctant to bring up, but I feel like our country is in a lot of turmoil right yes. now before the election. And I read in the book that nobody gets to be leader without God wanting them to be. And so I pray that the one that the Lord wants will be it, and we'll be able to live with it. And the verse that I had today, you know, I love listening to Elizabeth and her points of view, and she's way more forgiving than I am with Sunday go to meeting Christians. You know, I did it all my life up until after the year 2000, and my wife still goes to a Sunday church, but I kind of look at it like it's a commandment of the Lord. You know, there's 10 commandments, and right in the middle of them is this one that says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Well, the Lord was talking right after the, you know, in the Sermon on the Mount, what it says is that the Torah is no, there won't be one jot or tittle that will pass away before all is fulfilled. And so whoever teaches these commandments with the least of the commandments, which I consider the Christian church says is even the Sabbath. That's the least one. They don't have any problem with thou shalt not murder or thou shalt not commit adultery. Mm-hmm. But the one about the Sabbath, they think, well, that doesn't matter. Well, it says that the Lord said if whoever annuls one of the least of these commandments will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. So the verse that I had today was the Lord quoted Isaiah, and he said, but in vain do I worship you, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. I consider going to church on Sunday a commandment of men. And that is what I've come in my own self to think of as the mark of the beast. The scribes and the Pharisees are the beasts, and no Sunday preachers want to be called a scribe or a Pharisee, but I kind of read it like that. And it's Mark 7:7. It's an easy thing to remember. And so, but in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men.
Abba Father, I ask your blessing upon these people. I ask your grace upon our hearts. And I ask that we seek after you, not just on Shabbat, not just on Saturday mornings, but all week through. The Lord bless you.
The Lord bless you.
And keep you.
And keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you.
The Lord bless you.
The Lord bless you.
And keep you.
And keep you.
The Lord make his face to shine upon you. And be gracious unto you. And be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Shabbat shalom, shalom aleichem, peace be with you.
Amen.